there's more to preparing for an emergency situation than just preparing for the physical aspect of emergencies. Obviously, you want to have your food, your water, you want to have basic necessities, whether it be beans and rice in a bag, beans in a can, peanut butter, freeze-dried food, whether it be in a number 10 can or a pouch, or MREs, and of course, water, which incorporates water filters and water purification tablets. You want to have plenty of water. You want to have a means of protecting yourself. By protecting yourself, I mean obviously self-defense, firearms, but also simple things like protecting your feet with quality boots. Preparing for an emergency consists of many different aspects. Obviously, there's a physical. You want to talk about security. You want to be prepared to physically defend your family and your person. But there's also the psychological aspect of it, dealing with loss, dealing with a transformation of your society, a transformation of your community, really adapting to change. And there's a lot of things you can do psychologically to really prepare for something like that. I'm no expert, but when you look at the Great Depression and how people lost their livelihoods and even some people lost their lives because of the economic depression, when you look at the Black Death and how that transformed society, how a lot of people lost their lives in that situation, and the plague, and of course the aftermath of that, and how that affected the labor markets. There's a lot to be learned from those type of situations, a lot to be learned from that stuff. And one thing to keep in mind is that human beings have been through a lot. And just because our society is transformed, just because we may experience a population reduction, a big event, that doesn't mean that we should really give up. And that's really the core of this. Why should we continue? Why should we not give up? And we all have to discover why we get up every day and why we move forward. Because if we don't have that before a big crisis, we might not have it after a big crisis. Some people may experience a big crisis and actually discover a meaning for their lives. They may see a need in their community and feel like, okay, I actually have a purpose in my community. If you don't have a vision for your purpose in your community right now, it's going to be very difficult, I imagine, after a big event. So that's something to keep in mind. What type of role you want to play in your community? How do you want to affect people around you? So even if there's a big event where there's loss of life, if you have some type of focus, some type of purpose, then maybe that might make things a little bit easier. The small things, how do you keep yourself occupied when you're socially isolated? You have to have the power of discernment. You have to know when is a good time to just bug in, stay in your house, stay off the streets, or when is a good time to sort of connect with people around you and get information and really start to build. That's just something you gotta really be able to measure. You gotta be able to discern that. You also have to learn situational awareness, things like this. You have to sort of develop ahead of time. You gotta develop a pattern of working through consequences, thinking ahead. Okay, if I do this, how will this person respond? How will this likely impact my situation? Once you get used to start to do things like that, even in normal situations, then they'll start to kick in. Psychologically, you just start to kick in, even if there is an emergency. So it's sort of like, in a way, you know, your target shooting when it comes to your guns and stuff like that, they say that, you know, the way you practice is the way you might really perform in a real situation. We'll see. It's just something to keep in mind. These are important things to really consider. Being without family, being without loved ones, being isolated, losing people. When I lose somebody close to me, I don't try to focus on the death. I try to focus on the life. The fact that I was fortunate to have that person in my life. I was fortunate to be positively impacted by that person. And that's what I try to focus on. Moving forward in a big loss situation, or in a crisis in a community, I can focus on, okay, how can I live my life in a way that honors a person? And that's a proactive way I can move forward. That's something to keep in mind in a situation where there's a significant loss in your community and there's a SHTF type of scenario, grid down, a lot of suffering. You may be socially isolated, something to think about. Dealing with a lot of loss all around you. Maybe that's a strategy you might want to employ. Something to think about. So you have to find your own purpose for why you want to continue. This whole discussion began when I was speaking with this young woman. She was talking about, okay, in a really bad, she mentioned a zombie apocalypse, for example. You know, with such a loss of life, what would be the point of moving forward if we lost so much? And that whole discussion has really got me thinking about, okay, why should we move forward? And that's why I'm really thinking about this. Why should we move forward? I think preparing psychologically for a big event is really important. It's just as important as preparing for the physical. And it's just something I just wanted to mention. So guys, how do you prepare psychologically for SHTF, different SHTF scenarios? How do you prepare yourself mentally for maybe being socially isolated, or you're watching your community transform? Something to think about. So thank you guys for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. Oh, I want to mention some of the supplements I've been taking. A new one, garlic. It's supposed to help your heart. I've been doing it, taking a couple of these per day. Gonna try it out. Vitamin D is the main thing. I try about two of these a day. I consistently consume the vitamin D. It's supposed to help your bone and your immune system. I've been doing that ever since COVID. In the last month or so, I've been using the fish and flaxseed oil. These pills, one a day, for one a piece, every single day. Well, just about every single day. Zinc has a, Zinc Max. I use this maybe a couple times a week. Not really every day. It's supposed to have some vitamin C support. Some vitamin C, so. And I also have some vitamin C. I also consume the vitamin D bears, little gummy bears. So I don't know how effective that is, but it's just something I've been imploring, because vitamin D deficiency is a serious issue when it comes to COVID. And just something to keep in mind. So share your thoughts. Are you guys taking any type of supplements? Are you doing anything different? I'm not really doing the OMAD diet anymore, but I am walking 20,000 steps a day, about 9 miles. So basically, from the time I get up to the day to the point I go to sleep, I usually end up walking about 9 miles, sometimes 10 miles, but definitely at least 20,000 steps per day. And I've been walking this trail. It's about 2.25 miles. It's a bike trail, and I walk from one end to the other, so it's a total of 4.5 miles. And it goes up and down, up and down, and it definitely gets me sweating. So at the very least, I do feel healthier. I am in better shape. I'm able to walk that trail without, I don't have to stop or anything like that. So I do feel healthier doing that. So there you go.